Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I hope everybody's doing well. At least we're all in one piece.
Yes.
When I got up this morning, I started thinking about Thanksgiving. Not the holiday, but Thanksgiving in general. And I've been thinking about throughout the day. And one of the things that I was thinking about was these people that call themselves atheist or agnostic that still celebrate the holiday, I wonder who do they think they're giving thanks to, you know? And I was talking to my mom about that today, this afternoon, and I was telling her that to me, it always comes back to the same thing. No matter what, they can rationalize it, give you arguments, whatever they want to do. It all comes down to the same thing. God is the author of everything. Mm-hmm. So no matter what they say, well, I'm thankful for the food, okay? How'd you get the food? Well, the farmer planted the seed, okay? Where'd that seed come from? From the fruit of the tree, okay? Where'd the tree come from? From the seed, and you keep going in a circle. Because they run out of arguments. And then I was thinking about how blessed I am because although I am here alone, I have this family here in this church that I know cares for me and loves me. And the Lord showed me this past few days that He's taking care of me and by putting people in my life. I received 5 different invitations to spend Thanksgiving with different people. So it's like, whoa. So I was thinking about that today. I'm like, wow, man, you know, just that thing, the fact that someone looks at you and say, hey, do you want to spend Thanksgiving with me? That's a blessing in itself because that's proof right there of what God is doing in your life. Mm-hmm. So I kept thinking more of that, and I said, well, when I talk about this in church, I want to have a scripture to kind of summarize what I have been thinking about today. And I found this one that I think it does basically summarizes everything that I have been feeling today. And this is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I'm going to start reading in verse 7. It says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, I believe, and so I spoke. We also believe, and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God.
Amen.
Amen. To me, it's no coincidence that I've gotten those invitations. To me, that's just proof that, you know, like you said before, Pastor, it's as simple as saying, yes, Lord, I believe you. It's that easy. That's all you have to do. As soon as you say that, everything else is going to come falling right after it. And it's going to keep coming and coming and coming, the blessing and the wisdom and the grace and the transformation of your spirit, the renewal of your mind, everything is going to come like a domino effect. Mm-hmm. Just by saying, yes, Lord, you're my Savior. I want you in my life. So, I don't know, I'm just thankful for everything that has happened to me. and for everything that the Lord has given me, and for the way my mind, my life, and my spirit have been changed into the person that I am today, which is not the person that was before I said yes to the Lord. I wasn't a bad person, but I was a completely different person. And I'm very grateful that he brought me here, because I know that you care for me, that you love me, and that you have taken me into your homes and into your lives. And it's really nice for me to see a smile on your faces when I walk through the door, because it shows that you genuinely like me and love me for who I am.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Amen. That's my Thanksgiving. Anyone want to share testimony, prayer request? Yes.
I just want to thank God that, like you said, when you put him first in your life, if you focus on him and not at the stuff, manifestations, the stuff, it just happens. I've missed a great deal of work, and by rights, if I worked for a different employer, I probably would have lost my job a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
But I went and had a meeting with my boss yesterday. He wants me to come back. He's anxious for me to come back. And there was one person there that I would like to believe she's maybe bipolar.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. She could just be so, so nice, but so, so evil like that. And it was a little bit weighing on me, just kind of dreading having to face her,
mm-hmm.
and just the whole process. And in my meeting with him, I found out that today was her last day there. So, you know, God just takes care of everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm thankful for a good job, and that he takes care of every little worry and every little need that you have.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Sorry. One of the things that was probably the most revealing thing the Lord has given me is I've listened to this song called None But Jesus a couple of times, and there's this line in the chorus that says, "Crucified to set me free."
Mm-hmm.
And I've listened to that many times. This particular day, as soon as I heard that line being sung by the lady, that moment my eyes were open to this different truth that I had not come to understand up until that point. And that's another thing that I'm grateful for, you know. I don't think anyone will ever be able to understand what doing that actually means. So I'm just, thank you, Lord, because you did that. Because
yeah.
I don't understand it, but that's how much you love me. So.
Yeah. Amen.
Okay. Yes, James.
I was thankful. I know Jim has pneumonia, but I didn't know if it was daughter. And I said, well, so I've got to work through him eventually. We have to pray for him. I said, he gets a little better, but he's still right at the moment. He can't do anything. It's not under his control. It's under God's control. He doesn't. He's so weak with pneumonia. Can't. And I just pray for him. Pray for his daughter, Cindy, that's trying to deal with this thing, and they can talk to their social worker and get him over in Des Moines where they can work, like, look at him and take care of him. stand in the gap where we're supposed to be. And I love you guys always and always will.
Yes, Mike.
I left out Mark, Zach, and Laura. It's going to be an awkward time tomorrow, Thanksgiving time. I'm being separated. So just, I messaged Kayla, Bradley's friend out there at Bethel, and her and her prayer group out there is praying for Laura in California while they're right down, what, we figured 600 miles away from her or whatever on Sunday, but they're praying for her also. So we're believing God for healing for her and getting Mark and Zach and their family all restored totally.
Amen. All right, let's stand. Father, we thank you, Lord, for everything that you give us. We thank you, Father, for bringing us together as your children. You call us and you have a way of putting us into each other's lives for the purpose that you have brought us here, Lord. The purpose that is still being revealed, but we wait with anticipation every moment that you are going to reveal things to us, Lord. We lift up all of those, Father, that are in need of healing, and we declare right now in Jesus' mighty name that that healing has been received, Lord. We know that you have declared that it is finished, and the blessing is there. It just needs to manifest, and we declare right now the manifestation of that blessing. Father, we bring those that need restoration to you. We know, Father, that those relationships, you are going to mend whatever it is that needs mending. We thank you, Father, for everything that you do, for the blessing, for the provision, for your grace, Father, that you pour on us without us asking anything, without asking anything in return. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. We are your children because you call us your children. The expectation, Lord, of what you are going to do in our lives, in the lives of those around us, in this region, in this country, in this world, Lord, because you are here with us. Thank you, Father. Give you all the praise and glory, Father. Thank you, Lord, in your mighty name. We accept your blessing. December 5th, we have Eastern Gate House of Prayer. It's going to be good.
It's on.
Yeah, it's coming.
It's on.
And we have our soup dinner, December 14th. It's also going to be good. All right, speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Santiago, would you do us the honors of taking the offering, please? No. At least that's how the book is called in the Bible in Spanish. Thank you, Jesus. We love your presence, Lord. We already feel your presence here, Lord. For you alone are worthy, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for you alone are worthy, 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 worthy. All of our cares and troubles at your feet, Lord, for you alone are worthy, 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 Lord. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you chose to be with your children, Lord, this night. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, 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 Lord. You brought us safely, Lord, from the north, south, and east, and the west, Lord. Oh, just to be in your presence, Lord. To be in your presence, Lord. To touch those souls in this area, Lord. To touch them, their spirit, to release your spirit in this region, Lord. Oh, Lord. Even through the broadcast, Lord. Even through the
broadcast, Lord, that your Spirit move beyond these walls into the reaches of the world, the reaches of the world, the reaches of the world, to mend up the brokenhearted, Lord, to bring them freedom with your truth, freedom with your truth, Lord. Let your ministering Spirit, let your ministering Spirit move, Lord, move, Lord, move, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
wasn't a waste, I'd rather be, Lord, than in your presence, Lord. Hold me close, Lord. Hold me close, Lord. In the shadow of your wings, Lord. In the presence of your spirit, there is liberty. There is freedom. There is freedom. Nowhere else I'd rather be, Lord. Yours is the glory forever.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, for your goodness, your kindness, for your provision, Lord, for never leaving us or forsaking us, Lord. Thank you for making it all about you and not about us, Lord. We're grateful, Lord, for every grace gift that comes to us, for every gift that comes is a gift of grace coming down from you, Lord. The unchanging, invariable, always the same, loving God who seeks to pour out his blessings and his gifts upon his children. And we thank you for that tonight, Lord, for all that you've done, all that you're doing, and all that you will do forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight. And actually, I apologize. If I had known that the weather was going to be as bad and the streets as messed up as they are, I would have canceled church. But silly me, I believe the weather man. And that inch to inch and a half to maybe 2 inches of snow we were going to get, that was all going to be over by 4 o'clock this afternoon. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. But I am thankful tonight that my pickup is still in one piece, and all that snowplow got was my taillight. Praise the Lord. And a little bit of my... Praise the Lord. Self-control. Praise God. But Sally suffered the wrath of most of that because he got away in the snowplow. And then Sally tried to tell me to slow down, and I said, I think you just need to sit there and be quiet, because I know what I'm doing. She had already told me not to turn around in a ditch, which wasn't a ditch, by the way. It looked like one from her side of the truck, but it wasn't. Praise the Lord. Bless her heart. I know she's trying to be helpful, but in stressful situations, I do not take
advice.
I don't take instruction. I don't take anything very well. Praise the Lord. I'm large and in charge when I'm behind that wheel. Praise the Lord. Or at least half that action. Praise God. Amen. So I'm gonna be brief tonight so that you can get out of here, and hopefully the traffic will have got down to some kind of normal. And take your time, everybody. Please be careful going home. Get home safely and enjoy the holiday. Just take your time, get there in one piece. God be with you, amen. I know he will. Praise the Lord. So I'm going to be brief tonight, and I just want to talk to you about a few things, and especially where this grace message, you know, it is about, it's hard not to see it as just continuous about me and us in terms of what God's doing, not in what we do, but everything he's doing for us. But there is a way this translates, and I think where the church has really failed in general is by not receiving the message of grace in its totality and in its extreme radicalness. We have therefore been unable to share that with the world, with the unsaved, with the non-believer, if you will. And that's what we're here for, by the way. Jesus came to reveal the Father and his love, for God so loved the world, amen. And then we've, speaking, you know, just generally, have turned it into this thing about get better, you know, do good and be a better person and be you get holy and get righteous as though there were some way you could do that, and then constantly beat people up for not being perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And in the church and out of the church. So that's, you know, we need to embrace this message wholeheartedly, completely, body, soul, and spirit, so that we can be the messengers, amen, that God wants us to be, the carriers of light, amen.
Yeah.
So let's begin, and we'll move quickly here so we can move on and get on about our celebrating and thanking the Lord for another year of protection and blessing and all of his goodness, amen.
Amen.
In spite of everything else, praise the Lord, we're still here, we're still blessed. Amen. And we have a good future, the one that he plans for us. Praise the Lord. So Colossians chapter 2 and verses 13 and 14 is where we'll begin. We'll read three scriptures here and then we'll move around a little bit, have some more scriptures. And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. But he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. For not he that commendeth himself is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians 11, verses 1 through 3. Would to God you could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear lest it by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Praise the Lord. Now, verses, same chapter 13 through 15. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works.
Mm-hmm.
Notice, to their works.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So, the law was given to remove the sense of self-righteousness. Amen. Under the old covenant, the reason the law was given, so that we wouldn't be self-righteous.
Right.
Amen. That's the oddity of this is, every time the law is preached, there's still this sense of self-righteousness and pride that always rises up. And Paul says that this is demonic. Now, I mean, I just think in your head for a moment of all of the churches in all of the world that are still preaching this message of self-righteousness,
mm-hmm.
of you doing things to be better, and then getting beat up by the ministry or by others,
right.
for not living up to whatever their particular standard is, and it just promotes this attitude of self-righteousness, which is so anti-God. It's anti-Jesus. It's anti-Christian, to be quite honest with you. So, and the reason that God is so adamant about this is that Satan has no defense against grace. He has every defense when we start spouting the law. That's his little game. I mean, that's what he did with Adam and Eve, knowledge of good and evil, you know? And so he always has a weapon to use whenever you go to the law or to self-righteousness or your own holiness or your own whatever. He's always got weapons there that he can use, and they're right here.
Right.
So the thing, the one thing that he doesn't have any armor to defeat or any weapon to come against or any way and to be victorious is against grace. Praise God. So the accuser of the brethren accuses us how? By using the law, right? That's his weapon. That's what he uses. Now, people would think, oh, no, he doesn't use the law. He uses your sinful behavior or he tempts you to do bad stuff. No, it's the law that he always uses. He always goes back to the law. You didn't keep this commandment. You didn't do this. You didn't do that. Or you broke this one. Or you did this thing or that thing. Amen? He always does it. All right, Colossians chapter 2 again. Let's look at verses 14 and 15 this time. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. This is what grace did. Because remember, grace is a person.
Right.
It's not a doctrine or a ism. It's a he. It's a who. And blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And by so doing, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. He stripped them of the one thing that they could use against us. Amen. And then exposed their weakness, defenselessness, if you will.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, under the old covenant, we see things. Let's look at Matthew chapter 10, verse 38. Now, this stuff gets preached in the New Testament. I mean, it's getting preached in New Testament churches, in covenant churches. I'm not saying we don't believe the Old Testament. We just have to understand what the Old Testament's all about. It's pointing us to Jesus. It's not about stuff we're supposed to be doing.
Right.
He that taketh not his cross, this is Jesus speaking, he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. And people, you'll hear it all the time, take up your cross and follow Jesus. That's old covenant because it's talking about your identity. Your new identity. Your new identity is to be crucified with Christ.
Right.
That hasn't happened yet when Jesus is saying this. That's why he's telling them to take up their cross
and
follow me, right? Because under the new covenant, Paul never says take up your cross.
Right.
Why? Well, look at Romans chapter 6, verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Right? Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So Paul never says, take up your cross and follow Jesus. Why? Because you've already been crucified with Christ.
Yes.
Amen. When you get born again, that's what happens. Amen. You've been crucified. Therefore, it's not about you getting a new identity. You have a new identity.
Yes.
You are a new creature in Christ.
Yes.
Jesus is saying you need a new identity. Just like he told the rabbi, you got to be born again. Amen. That's just another way of saying take up your cross. You've got to have an identity change. You have to be born again, and you get that is part and parcel of what we're talking about. You can't just enter into eternal life without the old man dying.
Right.
So he's crucified, he gets buried, and then the new creature in Christ, the new identity of who you are in Christ, rises with him and will forever be with the Lord. Amen. He came into you, the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit comes into you and seals you. Your spirit has been sealed with the Holy Spirit for eternity. It can't be undone.
Right.
The flesh is not what got sealed.
Right.
The flesh is just the thing that's carrying it around on this planet right now.
Right.
But you got sealed in Christ by the Holy Spirit so that you can never be taken out. You can never fail.
Exactly.
You can never undo what Christ has done. Praise God. You have received this new identity. What is the new identity? Well, under the old covenant, it was us trying to be righteous, self-righteous.
Right.
That's what the law exposes. Well, the new identity in the new covenant, where we no longer are taking up our cross because we've been crucified, is now we are the righteousness of God in Christ. That's our new identity. That's what God calls us. That's what how we are to see one another even. Yes. Amen? Yes. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1. If you can be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Amen?
Amen.
Blessings forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. Holy, the holiness of God, the presence of God.
Yes.
Amen. All of that your inheritance has to offer you is what you're supposed to be looking for. And I don't mean rooting around in the cellar. I mean looking as if to expect it, looking for it, believing for it, imagining it. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5. 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We've talked about this before, but just as a kind of reminder here, everything that tries to, everything your mind tries to conjure up that you should do, that you should achieve or accomplish, amen, every high thing, every self-righteous act, so to speak, that exalts itself above the knowledge of God and bring into captivity every thought, all of those thoughts, to the obedience of Christ, to what Christ has already done. Every time the enemy comes and tells you, you just failed there miserably, and now, you know, you're in trouble, God's not going to talk to you for a few days or a week or whatever, and whatever that blessing was you needed, you know, that's on the back burner. Now you may or may not get it, because after all, look what you've done or how you behave or whatever. I mean, no, bring that thought into the obedience of what Christ has done. Recognize, hey, I am the righteousness of God. Thank you, Father. Bless me. I need this. I'm looking forward to this blessing that you have promised me in your word. I have every right to come to you by the blood of Jesus. I come not by my own merit, but who I am in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm grateful.
Amen.
That you've promised me that you'd never fail me, that you'd never leave me or forsake me, that you would supply all of my need according to your riches and glory.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
That you would do exceeding abundantly above all that I could ask or think. I haven't even dreamed up the big thing that I would like you to do for me that you're already planning to do.
Yeah.
Exceeding abundantly above all that I could ask or think in Christ. You know, so there's no limit. We need to be that way. We need to be bold. Instead of this sheepish, you know, I'm coming, but, you know, I know it's kind of like you didn't do any work all week, so you back up in the pay line to pick up your check because you just kind of hung out. You want the check, but you didn't do anything, you know. God says, no, just come right to the front of the line, grab the check, and we're good to go. It's all good. Praise the Lord. All right, Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Now notice this, and I think we have talked about this before too. Shepherds were like the lowest caste, you know, in the system there.
Right.
They were the lowest economic group, least respected, I mean, the whole thing. And he comes to them. And the angel comes and declares the coming of the Lord. And here's the message that he says. Now listen, how many, do you really ever hear the church talking to people out there in the world that are lost, that are living, you know, all kinds of destructive and messed up lives? And do you ever hear the church coming to them and say, man, have I got good news for you. God loves you. God has come to bless you right in the midst of all your crap, all the junk that you're in, your condition, your attitude, your, you know, your finance, whatever it is. And God loves you so much, he's come to save you right now. He loves you. He wants to do stuff for you. He wants to bless you. No, we usually say, you know, come on down to the church and we'll get you in a three-step program and get you off of that and get you off of this. And, you know, we'll give you, a support group, or, you know, we'll pray for you. Because you got to get your act together here, man. I mean, you can't be living like this if you want to have fellowship with us. If you want to be part of our group, you know, you got to be really good. Well, of course, they know that if they could be good, they would already be good, wouldn't they? I mean, it's not a question of can I. It's I can't. And so I've got to the point now where I've realized that I can't, so I'm not going to. I'm just not going to frustrate myself and humiliate myself by trying only to fail. Right?
Right.
This is what God says. There's no failures. I succeeded, so there cannot be any failures.
Amen.
If you'll just come. Because that's why I came. I came first. I came to you. I came and I did. And all you got to do is receive it. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So we need to make people, and I think I've said this before, but it bears repeating. We need to make people wish that the gospel was true.
Exactly.
Instead of trying to convince them that the gospel isn't true. I mean, here we are supposed to be preaching the truth, and we're telling it in a way that it isn't true.
Right.
We need to make people once again just say, oh, God, I wish that were true. I wish that were the case. I wish that's what it was. Amen? And then show them that it is.
Yeah.
Right.
By the way we interact with them, by the way we treat them, by the way we reach out to them, the way Jesus did it. Not, let's forget the church paradigm. Let's forget the church's schematic, if you will, for this, or their programs for doing it. Let's just forget all of that and go back to the basics of what Jesus did and do that. Just love them. Just accept them. Just don't try to get them all straightened out. Just try to love them and let God do the straightening out. If it takes 20 years, it takes 20 years. They need God today, whether they get off of their whatever else their issues are today or not. The likelihood of them getting off of it without God are far less than they are with God.
There you go.
And it's His business, not ours. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we'll read verses 14 through 21. 2 Corinthians 5, 14 through 21. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge, that if one died for all, then we're all dead. Amen.
Amen.
That he died for all, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Now, we've read that in the context of, well, I got to give everything up, and that's not what he's saying.
Right.
He's saying what Paul said in Romans.
Mm-hmm.
I was crucified with Christ,
right,
yet I live. But it's not me that lives. It's Christ. That's what he's trying to get us to understand. He's not saying, I want you to just shun, go off and live in a cave somewhere and contemplate your navel and forget everything else. No, he's saying, this is the reality. You need to see yourself the way God sees you.
Exactly.
That is dead, because he died for everybody.
Yep.
You are alive now, but you are alive in Christ. That's how God sees you, as
yes,
Christ.
Yes.
Christ-like. Amen. So he died for all, that they which should not, they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves.
Right.
The way they did under the old covenant. But unto him which died for them and rose again. It's like saying, look at the accomplishments of Christ, or the faithfulness of Christ, not yours. Look at his.
Right.
Look what he accomplished. Look what he completed. Look what he did.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way you need to see. Amen?
Amen.
Wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Because think about this. We look at people out here in the world and we see them as Christians, non-Christians, right?
Right.
Unbelievers, as Roberto was saying, atheists, agnostics. I said before, and that's what he was saying tonight, they're just stupid. They're just confused people. They're just ignorant. Because Jesus died for them, whether they admit it or not.
Right.
Whether they believe it or not.
Right.
He still did. And as far as he's concerned, they're dead.
Right.
The only way to come alive is to believe. But that's all they got to do.
Right.
Yes.
Because he's already declared them dead.
Right.
Amen. So, though we have known Christ,
Christ hath the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us this ministry of reconciliation. How did it happen? It happened all by grace.
Yes.
Period. That's the only ministry we have,
yes,
is to offer grace. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Now, we love that. I mean, the church loves it. He's not imputing our trespasses. But what about them? Are we still imputing their trespasses against them? You see what I'm saying? And we go, oh, well, you got to be careful because, you know, then it's a license. Hey, that's not your job.
That's
right. That isn't your job. That's not my job. Our job is to give them the gospel,
yes,
to give them the grace.
Yes.
Just because it took us 30 years to get it, you know, after we were in church, doesn't mean they have to. They could come in immediately,
yes,
as mature Christians, yes, if they understood some of this stuff. Because,
yes,
most of us remained immature because we wrestled with these different truths, not knowing how to balance them. And we were trying to, you know, mix the message.
Yeah.
And that little leaven leavened the whole lump, you know, messed everything up. So imagine what people could do if they came in knowing this from the very beginning as they first come to God, how fast they could evolve, you know, in their Christian walk.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. I mean, from an external perspective, not who they are. It's just the same. It's done. But you know what I mean? So hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, that wit, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, God gave me that scripture years ago. I thought it was, you know, just preach the gospel.
Yeah.
Problem was, I didn't know the gospel.
Yeah.
I was preaching what I thought was the gospel. But you can't reconcile anybody to God with my method. The only way anybody can truly be reconciled to God is through Jesus Christ, through grace, by grace. It can't be done any other way.
Right.
You cannot be Adam and Eve weren't reconciled to God because they got more information about bad behavior.
Right.
They got alienated.
That's right.
They got afraid. They got scared. Amen. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, therefore, because of, after that, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, because it's happened to us.
Yes.
Right.
Amen. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, in the place of Christ. The same, we're saying what Jesus would say if he's here looking at you. Amen. Be ye reconciled to God.
Right.
I thought he just said they were reconciled to God. Well, if you're reconciled to God, you'll be a reconciler. That's what he's saying. He's not saying you didn't get reconciled. He's saying the evidence of your reconciliation would be you become a reconciler.
Right.
You start reproducing,
exactly,
grace babies.
Yes.
Not the hard work, long prayer time,
yes,
all that stuff. Not that anything's wrong with that, but only when it becomes the way we do it, rather than just our relationship. Amen. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So, the only way that we'll be able to reach people for Christ is to differentiate legalism from the gospel. Separate it. Identify it. When they start asking those questions, you know that they're going to ask because they've been told that from somebody else.
Right.
Praise God. From a human standpoint, we've got to help them understand that rules and regulations and standards and behavior modification are not the core truth or the heart of Christianity. It's not what Christianity really is. In spite of what we've been teaching and preaching for 2,000 years, that's not what it is. That's not what it's about. Not if you really honestly look and read the scriptures in the context that they should be read through the eyes of Jesus, through the person of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? We've got to show people that the gospel is radically different than anything they've heard before.
Yes.
Because it is. And when they hear it, they'll say, that can't be true. And then you show them why it is.
Right.
That's too good to be true. It can't be like that. Because I've heard, oh, I got to do this and do that. And after all, my life's a total disaster. And because even without a religious background or religious teaching, the world has its own ideas that you work hard, you do good, like Don was saying here last Sunday. You know, this is the whole attitude of the world. The church has just incorporated it into the what they call the gospel. They need to know, the world needs to know, and the church for that matter needs to know, this is something radically different than anything we've ever been dealing with in the past. Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 2, and let's read 4 through 13. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. How did you receive Christ? By grace. You didn't do anything, but you just believed. That's all you did, right? So as ye have therefore received Christ, Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. Live your life the same way you got it. By just believing that he's done it all. He's finished it. He's provided everything. He's taken care of everything. All you got to do is stay focused on him. Mm-hmm. Rooted and built up in him. Not in you. Not in your most holy doctrine. Amen. But in him. Right? And established in the faith. What faith? The faith of Christ. Mm-hmm. What Jesus, the faith he exercised to do what he did for us. Mm-hmm. As ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. You'd be thankful if you really understood it, but most Christians aren't thankful because they're still trying to do it themselves.
Right.
They're just tired.
Yes.
Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. I said Sunday. That's the battle. The battle is between truth and error. The truth of the gospel, the real truth of the gospel, and the philosophy of this world, and the philosophy of religion. Mm-hmm. Because religion, as we've seen it, is more philosophy than it is gospel. And that's what Paul's talking about. Philosophy and what? Vain deceit. Vanity. A deception. To believe in your righteousness. After the tradition of men. After the rudiments of the world. And not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And ye are what? Complete in him. What does that mean? It means it's complete. It's finished. Right? Which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in the putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. You were nipped. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And that worthless skin that was removed had all the sin in it. That's the metaphor he's using here. Praise the Lord. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead, and you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. That's everything. I mean, you've got to try to misunderstand that. You've got to work to not understand what he's saying here. Praise God. We need to somehow, we got to make it clear that Jesus came first not to make bad people good, but to make dead people alive.
Amen.
That's his purpose. That's what he's all about. Amen? Amen? The primary goal of the gospel is to bring about a mortal resurrection,
yes.
Not a moral reformation.
That's right. Amen.
That's good.
It's not about my need to do, but it's what Jesus has already done.
Yes. Yes.
All right? A couple more scriptures here. Matthew chapter 10, verses 7 and 8. I tell you what, this is really good news for me.
Yes.
I've had a bad week. Praise the Lord.
Jesus.
I mean, I've had a good week in Jesus.
Yeah.
But I've had a bad week.
Uh-huh.
He tries to resurrect here. For this cause shall all men leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh, so then they are no more twain but one flesh.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Is that Matthew 10? I was going to have trouble trying to connect that with anything. We'd have gone off into a whole new message here.
Yeah.
Okay, here you go. And as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely give. Here's what you preach.
Yeah.
Grace has come.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's the kingdom of heaven, where everything is taken care of, everything provided for, everything is done. And the result of that preaching, you heal the sick, you raise the dead, you cast out demons. Not because of a religious stuff, not because of a doctrinal message, quote unquote, but by preaching grace, by preaching the truth, the ministry automatically becomes one of supernatural and miraculous.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Look at Romans chapter 3. And verse 24. Because this is about dispensing grace. Anybody ever see a sinner get healed?
Yep.
In a service? I have.
Yep.
Lots of times. Did they come back and join the church? Not always. In fact, more times than not, they didn't. They got healed and went on their way. Happy they were healed. God didn't heal them because of their doctrine. He healed them because of his love.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because of the finished work of the cross.
Right.
Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
Justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So here's the deal. Christians are the sole dispensers of grace.
Yes.
We're the only ones that can do it.
Right.
That's why he tells us, whose sins you forgive, I forgive.
Yes.
Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. Why? Because you're the only ones that can do it. You are the sole dispensers of grace. If you don't dispense grace, there's no grace dispensed.
Right.
That's the weight and responsibility that we have. That's the kind of confidence and faith that God has put in us.
Yeah.
To be his reconciler on this earth the same way Jesus was when he was here. That's why he says, you could do greater works.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
If you only knew.
Mm-hmm.
And the world is moaning and groaning. For what? For us to manifest. For us to do. We've talked about it in many different ways. But what is it? It's for us to start dispensing grace. That's what they're waiting for. That's what the whole earth is waiting for.
Yes.
That is simply God loving the undeserving. And it's more than a soup line. I'm not against that. It's more than a food kitchen or a clothing drive. Those things are good. I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. I'm just saying we have substituted that
right. For
grace.
Right.
For God's love for the undeserving.
Right.
We've tried to make him feel, I don't know, obligated.
Yep.
We'll give you food, but you got to listen to a sermon first. They do it all the time.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I understand the motive, but I'm just saying it's just misguided. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hebrews 12:15. This is the last one we'll quit. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up, trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. I want you to read this one more time. Look at this. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. amen, semicolon, lest any man, lest any root of bitterness spring up trouble you, comma, and thereby many be defiled. So what's he saying? Make sure no one misses the grace of God.
That's it.
That's the message.
That's it.
That's the ministry of reconciliation. Make sure nobody misses out on the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
It's simple. As long as we stay focused on the simplicity of Christ, the message remains simple, but so effective. It's so powerful. And it takes all of the weight off of you. All you got to do is just follow the first command, the new commandment, love. Just love them, forgive them, bless them, tell them how much God loves them, how God wants to prosper them, how God wants to turn their life around. And I don't mean turn it around so that they're not smoking dope or getting drunk. I mean turn it around so that the relationships can be established, so that they will choose to make good choices, not have somebody else make choices for them, and then make them feel obligated and, you know, weak and failures because they can't maintain it. Just, God loves you.
Amen.
If you choose to never stop doing what you're doing, God's love for you will remain. Your life will still have issues because of choices that you're making, but it will not alter God's love for you and his act of sacrifice that you might live eternally. You can be saved in the midst of all of that mess, even if in your mind you're saying, but I don't really want to change. It's not about you changing.
That's right.
It's about you accepting what Christ has done for your inability to change.
There you go.
Yes.
That's the message. That's the news. That's what people need to hear. That's what Jesus brought. You don't hear him telling the sinners what to do. They volunteered to do stuff.
Right.
He never told them, here's your list.
Right.
I'm coming to your house tonight, but you better have some stuff. You better have a prayer shawl out there. You better get a menorah up. You better have a cross hanging. You better have this. I don't want to smell any cigarette smoke. I don't want to see any red eyeballs. I don't want to smell any alcohol. And on and on and on. I don't want to hear any voices get raised. I don't want to hear any kind of, confrontational, voices. No. The only people he addressed in all of those meetings were the religious people that were sitting there complaining about the people that he was blessing.
Come on.
And every one of these parables he starts talking about, like prodigal son, all these others, it's not for the sinners he's telling those stories. It's for these self-righteous people.
Right.
He didn't have a problem with the sinner. They just knew they needed help, and I'll take whatever I can get. I can't make any promises today, but I do know I need what you got.
Amen.
While those that claim to have eyes are sitting there saying, I don't even know who he is. I don't want what he's got because he's sharing it with people that I don't want nothing to do with. And he's making it easy for them.
Yes.
When it's been tough for me, it's been hard for me. I've worked hard for this, to get this, self-righteousness and to be respected by other Christians and have this, level of, I'm somebody, When you're nothing, you're nobody in yourself. It's in Christ that you're more than a conqueror. It's in that resurrected reality that we are more than conquerors, that we can do all things, that we have this victory, that we have eternal life, that we have all the blessings of God.
Yes.
And what did we do to get it? Nothing. We just believe. We just believe. So what are we, why, it's like, it's like you run a 10-yard race, and you get a trophy, and you put the trophy up on the fire, on the mantle, and everybody comes in. Oh yeah, this is the big race I won, X number of years ago. Boy, I'd like to win a trophy like that. Okay, well, we'll set up a race for you. Of course, you got to run like 100 yards. I ran 10, but that's another story. You got to run 100, or you got to run a 220, or you got to run a 440. Because, I've arrived. I know where I'm at. But you got some issues, so you're gonna have to work a little harder at this to get the trophy. Well, they're not our trophies.
Right.
They're not our crowns.
Right.
They don't belong to us in the first place.
Right.
Amen. And in fact, in heaven, it isn't like we line up and he says, okay, I'm checking everybody's crowns and everybody's got one. I'm taking it. No, you'll be getting rid of that thing. It'll be like a hot potato. You won't be able to get rid of it fast enough because you know, I don't have any business holding this thing. It's not mine.
Right.
It was by his finished work that anything got accomplished.
Yes.
That's the way we need to address the people of this world, the unsaved. No, Paul said, I don't know anybody but Jesus. I don't see anybody but Christ.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And him crucified.
Yes.
That ought to be our attitude. That ought to be the way we look at it. It isn't just about a handout. It isn't just about the poor mess, you know. God loves them. God has the same value on their life, whether they turn it around or don't turn it around, whether they give it, you know, to Christ in terms of their addictions or whatever else it is. But just give them the chance to have eternal life.
Amen.
Just give them the opportunity to have the free gift that he gave us.
Amen.
Freely you've received,
freely
give. That's what he's talking about. It didn't cost you nothing.
Exactly.
Give it away.
Yep.
There's plenty more where that came from. That's the whole message of the gospel. It didn't cost you anything, so don't be so stingy and selfish with it.
Yes.
Give it.
Right.
Give it away.
Yes.
We love to preach that principle when it comes to finances and other stuff, you know. Let's try doing it with the gospel.
Come on.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. God bless everybody. Have a great Thanksgiving. Be sure and drive safe going home. And have a great time with your families. Enjoy your time off. And just eat like there is no such thing as calories. You got one day. This is the day we get to do it. And you just go for it. Just do it up. Praise the Lord. I saw a little bit of a show today where one family ate. What was that? Did you see that? 200 and some thousand calories. I can't remember. But they said, you know, everybody's freaking out. But they said, that's an average family. That's a typical family on Thanksgiving. And the funny part of it was one gal, she ate more, she had more calories leading up to the dinner than she got from the dinner itself.
Oh, wow.
This is really going to be good. Anybody do that? You know, I mean, try
the
sampler. I already ate the heart and the liver of the turkey at our house. So. I gave the gizzard or whatever it's called to the dog. It's too hard to chew, but. I eat the hearts and the livers. That's the good stuff. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless everybody. Again, drive careful going home. Have a great rest of your week. And come on back Sunday expecting God's grace to flow like a river. Amen. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.